Hey everyone, thank you for joining us online today. Sermons, devotionals, and links to our live stream are available on our church app, which is available on the Google Play and Apple App Store. Also, be sure to follow us on Instagram at CT Bentonville and to like us on Facebook at Calvary Tabernacle Bentonville. We also encourage you to continue to support the church through giving your tithe and offerings. You can do that online at ctbentonville.com or through our app. And if you would like to give a physical offering, you can mail that to P.O. Box 93, Bentonville, Arkansas 72712. Through the week, we would love to connect with you through one of our Zoom Bible studies. Check out our social media for information on how you can be a part of each of these. Before we get started, I've got a question for you. What do you know about baptism? Have you ever been baptized, or do you have questions as far as what it is or why we do it? We would love to answer those questions and schedule a time for you to be baptized if you're interested. Please reach out to us through one of our social media channels, and we would love to set you up with a minister to talk to you about the importance of baptism and schedule that. Now, thank you for tuning in. Turn off your notifications, shut out all your distractions, and lean in for a time of worship and the Word.
Things. Oh, sparkling wine. I see glory as I run inside the throne room. Before you, I bow.
See glory as I run in.
Worship him together right now. Lord Jesus, you are worthy of all glory. You are worthy of all honor and all praise. Holy is your name, Lord. Holy is your name, Lord. You are the King of glory. You are the King of glory. We worship and magnify and exalt your great and glorious name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. It's so good to have you today to our online church. Welcome. Thank you for joining us at CT on this Sunday morning. And our purpose today is twofold. First and foremost, we want to honor the Lord Jesus with everything that we say and that we do. And then second, we want to honor our mothers on this Mother's Day. And happy Mother's Day to you wonderful moms. Hope that you have had a very good week, and I pray many blessings upon you. I give honor to my amazing mother today. I could not have asked for a more godly and loving mother, and I thank her very much for her contribution and for all that she's done for me over the years, and I love her so much. And to my sweet wife, who I am constantly amazed by how she interacts and loves our daughter, Ava, thank you. Thank you very much, babe, for that. I honor you today. I have the highest respect and admiration for those who are blessed to be called mothers. There are a few assignments in human experience that require the array of skill and wisdom needed by a mom in fulfilling her everyday duties. She must be a resident psychologist, physician, theologian, educator, nurse, chef, taxi driver, fire marshal, and even an occasional police officer from time to time. And if she succeeds in each of these responsibilities, she gets to do it all again the next day. And so I'm amazed at you moms, and I am very thankful for you, and we give honor to you. According to the Bible, there is a lot more to being a good mom than simply making a tasty peanut butter and jelly sandwich without the crust. There is more to it than applying a Spider-Man Band-Aid or washing hair without getting water in the eyes. These are physical demands on mothers, but biblically, there are spiritual demands as well. And without question, the spiritual needs of children are even greater than the physical. You are called to pass on more than a good recipe book, mom, or skill in loading a dishwasher. Although those are great things to pass on, that's not all there is to pass on. You've been called to pass on the things of God. And so today I will ask you to open up to 2 Timothy because I want you to see the power of a godly mother in a child's life. Timothy was the spiritual son of Paul. And as far as we know, the Apostle Paul never married, nor did he have children, but he had spiritual children. Timothy was one of his boys, and Timothy was lucky to have such an incredible spiritual father in Paul. But long before Paul arrived on the scene, while Paul was studying the Pharisaical law and persecuting Christians, Timothy was growing up in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. And the reason that he was growing into a godly man was because he had two women in his life that were godly, righteous, firm, determined women who were tilling the soil, if you will, in his heart. His mother, Eunice, and his grandmother, Lois, were training that boy to be used mightily by God. And I want you to look at your Bible and listen to the passage of Scripture here in verse
chapter in verse 5, 2 Timothy 1 and 5. It says, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, I am persuaded that in thee also. The NIV says in 2 Timothy 1, 5, I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice. And I am persuaded now lives in you also. Paul saw in Timothy a legacy, and it began in a godly grandmother. God has given to you, grandmother, a unique perspective that hurried mothers don't always have. Proverbs 17:6 says, children's children are a crown to the aged. Timothy was blessed not only with a godly mother, but also with a godly grandmother. And when a child has those two things, he has more riches than Solomon in all his splendor. Now, what about the role of Eunice, Timothy's mother, who raised him and poured her life into him? What did she accomplish in that boy? I want to point out today three simple things that Eunice did for Timothy that all godly mothers should do with their children. Every mother should follow the example shown by Eunice here. Three things that Eunice did for Timothy. The first was that she passed on a love for the scripture. In 2 Timothy 3, 14 through 17, we see this. And from the time Timothy was born, God's word was discussed and taught in his home. Eunice made sure that Timothy understood the power of the word of God. Mothers, no single thing will have a greater impact on your child than the truth of Scripture. You can read all the parenting books about fun foods for your child or host thrilling birthday parties and top-notch arts and crafts projects. And those things are important and they're fine and they're great to have in your child's life. But if you want to hand your child a life-changing practice, it will be his or her ability to read and understand God's word. The word must be spoken and embraced in our homes. Timothy had the privilege of hearing and receiving that word in the most marvelous manner in his life. He heard it first from his family, more specifically from his grandmother and his mother. And he heard it from infancy. In Deuteronomy 6, the people of God are told this, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road and when you lie down and when you get up. What is God saying here? He's saying, don't expect the pastors to teach your child the scriptures. You teach them. It's your assignment. The idea is wherever you are, whatever you're doing, find ways to teach your children the truths of the Word of God. Moms, you must learn the Word if you are going to teach the Word of God. Read it, study it, and then whether you are traveling along the road or eating breakfast or singing a good night song, incorporate Scripture into your child's life. And guess what will happen? You will pass it on to them. Eunice loved the Word of God, and it changed her son's life. He went on to be one of the star pastors in the New Testament. And it happened because he loved the Bible. He loved the Holy Script. And he loved the Word because his mother loved the Word. And she loved it because her mother loved it. Pass it on from one generation to the next. The second thing that we learn from what she taught Timothy was that she passed on what the scripture says is a sincere faith. In 2 Timothy 1:5, we can look back at this and it again read this. I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. Because of genetics, you will pass on some traits to your children. Your child might have your big brown eyes, or your funny shaped nose, or your long toes, or your curly red hair. These things are hereditary. However, faith is not hereditary. Just because you follow Christ, this doesn't mean that your children will follow Christ. It's not hereditary. Now, I think the key word in this verse is sincere here. Paul saw in those two women a sincere faith that had been passed on. One of the easiest ways to destroy your children is to model a two-faced lifestyle. You must war against the spirit of hypocrisy that will worm its way into your life. We've got to be careful of this. The word hypocrite means someone who pretends. One of the favorite pastimes of a child is to pretend. I used to do it for hours when I was a kid, and that was to pretend. I pretended to be a cowboy. I pretended most all day long that I was a cowboy, or a football player, or a famous basketball player, and we would set the goal in the lowest setting, and we would dunk with the smallest ball you could get and pretended to be Michael Jordan. It was awesome. That's what we did. That's what I did. But as a child grows up, they begin to separate pretending from reality, and they recognize fake. I can do a few magic tricks with smaller children. I don't know if you can really even call them magic tricks, but I can do some things to fool them with sleight of hand, and when they're small, very small, because they can't quite pick up how fast my hand's moving, and I'm just slipping it in a pocket or throwing it behind my back or whatever it is, and it seems like I'm doing something really amazing, but I'm really not. But as they grow up, as those children grow up, they will know, they will pick up real quick on what's real and what's fake. They will know whether you are sincere about your relationship with God or whether you are a pretender when it comes to what you say and do. Your children are watching your faith. They're watching like a hawk. They want to know if you are authentic or if you are counterfeit, because they're watching and they're trying to determine what kind of life they need to live. They're asking the question, can I really have faith in an invisible God? How do I know that God exists? What has He done in my mom's life and my parents' life? And if that child cannot see in you a radically changed life, then that child will most likely grow up wondering, what difference does Jesus make? Has this so-called God really changed my mother's life? Or is this a religious game that she learned from her mother? Hypocrisy will kill your kids. I have a 12-year-old, and I'm realizing very quickly who the greatest influencer is in our home right now. And although I have maybe a heavier hand and a louder voice, my daughter absolutely adores my wife. She watches every move that she makes. I've watched it from a distance. I've observed this. And I've watched how she mimics my wife, and I've watched how she interacts with her, and she talks to her in private. I've watched those things. She is clinging on every word that her mother is saying, and she's watching every action. That is why it's very important that we pass on a sincere faith. Eunice was obviously a woman that was sincere and sensitive toward God. She did not put on a show. Moms, don't be just a churchgoer, but be a Christ follower every day. And when you fail, make it right before God and your children. The third thing that Eunice did is that she passed on a desire to serve others. We see this in Acts 16, 1 through 3. We see the life of Timothy here, And I want you to look at this passage in Acts. Paul came to Derbe and then to Lystra, where a disciple named Timothy lived, whose mother was a Jewish and a believer, but whose father was a Greek. The brothers at Lystra and Iconium spoke well. I don't think that's how you say it, but Paul wanted to take him along on the journey, so he circumcised him because of the Jews who lived in that area, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. I want you to notice that Timothy eagerly followed Paul into ministry. He knew that Paul had been stoned the last time he was in Lystra. He knew that he was leaving his mama and may never see her on this side of heaven again. But Timothy had been trained from childhood that his life was not his own, that God had made him with a purpose, and he was deeply committed to that purpose and to that ministry. Now, why did Timothy risk his life for a mission trip with Paul? I have a theory. I believe it was because he had watched his mother serve others for decades. It's what he had been trained to do. I cannot tell you, mothers, how important it is for your children to see you reaching out and caring for others. Teach your children how to give themselves away. Share a meal with a hurting family and let your child help you prepare that meal. Share your money with others and tell your kids about how it's helping someone else. Share your dinner table with people who need friendship and encouragement and uplifting. Share your time and devote energy to the work of the local church. Share your life with people, and guess what will happen? Your child will grow up with a desire to give themselves to God. And I want you to notice something else, mothers. In Acts 16, Timothy left his mother and followed the plan of God. Eunice knew that she must let her son go. That's a very hard thing for any parent, and it's extremely hard for a mother. Acts 16:4 does not say, "And Eunice ran to the side of Timothy to talk him out of this dangerous mission trip." She did not encourage him to stay home and start a family and have children quickly so that she could spoil them rotten. No, the Bible does not say that. The Bible says that Timothy went. At some point in time, you have to let those kids go, and that's hard, I know, but the truth is they are not really our kids to begin with. The Bible calls us pilgrims in this land, just passing through this earth, but it also describes us as stewards. The word steward means manager. And when you go to a restaurant and you meet the manager, you don't ask him, "What did you pay for this place?" He didn't buy it. It belongs to someone else. He is being paid to manage someone else's investment. That's the way the Bible describes everything in our life. Our money, our time, our assets, and even our children. These things, moms, you get to manage for a short time. So what does that mean? It means that we can't keep them forever. And it means that we've got to prepare them for where God wants them to go. Now, there is one more thing that I want to draw your attention to. I want you to notice that Timothy did have a father. In Acts 16, it says that his father was a Greek. And we have no indication that he ever became a believer in God. He may have been a nice man. He may have spent hours playing with his child, but it seems clear that he had zero spiritual influence over his children. Timothy was a mighty man of God. because he had a mighty woman of God in his life, in his mother. Mother, be encouraged. God can save a child's soul through the power of a godly mother. He can overcome any obstacle, for nothing is impossible with God. So mothers, on this Mother's Day, I want to remind you that you have a tremendous ministry. It's more than singing in a choir on a platform. It's more than being a teacher in a Sunday school class, but it's a teacher in your home. And it's a tremendous ministry of discipling your own personal child to know God. Pass on love for the Word to that child. Pass on a sincere faith to that child. And pass on a passion to serve others. Don't ever underestimate your purpose and your influence over your child's life. I suppose that as I was preparing for this, that I was reflecting on three of the most important things that my mother taught me. And it was those three things. She taught me the Word. I had a father that did that also, but she taught me the Word. She made sure that I was quoting that scripture and that I was quoting those verses. I could hear her singing often. I could hear her praying often. She taught me that. She showed me what a sincere faith looked like in her own personal walk with God. And then she displayed and passed on to me how to serve others above herself. And I thank God for that. I am only here today because of the ministry of my mother. So moms, you've been called to a ministry. It's your child above all else. So moms, I want to pray for you today. I want to pray over you today. Husbands, children in your home, will you gather around that mother and will you begin to pray for her as I pray over them right now? Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for these precious ladies of faith. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for the sacrifices that they make each and every day. And I thank you for godly women. I thank you for godly mothers who are passing on to their children, the next generation. Lord Jesus, a love for your Word, a passion for the things of your Word, for the truth, oh God, which we have in your Word. And I pray, Jesus, for that mother, Lord, that you would continually, each and every day, strengthen her in the midst of everything that she is bombarded by and the voices that are always pulling and Lord, tearing away, Lord Jesus, at her own faith. I pray, strengthen her right now so that she can continue, Lord Jesus, to anchor her child's life in the Word of God. And Lord Jesus, I pray that each and every day, Lord, as she faces trials and she faces situations, Lord Jesus, she will handle it, Lord Jesus, through a sincere faith in you, through crises and through difficult times and trials of life. God, that she will put her faith and her trust in you. A God, yes, who we cannot see, but yet we can feel, and that your Word, Lord, has spoken promises to us, and we cling to those promises. And so, God, I pray for that mother even now who is feeling weak and weary and beat down while trying, Lord, to be everything to everyone in their home and trying to teach their children at school. Their school now is in their home, and they're trying to do all of these things and balance all of these things and juggle the cares of life. I pray, God, that you would strengthen them to have that sincere faith in you during this time and this season. And I pray, God, that through it all, that their children will learn how to serve others, Lord Jesus, as they look to their moms and they look to those role models of God, these mothers who these children look up to so very much and who has given birth and life to them. Lord Jesus, I pray that they will see their mother as they are serving diligently. And Lord Jesus, with the right spirit and with a sincere faith, and doing it, Lord Jesus, as your word instructs. And I pray, God, that it will be passed on to the next generation, that they learn how to serve others as their mothers, oh God, have displayed and shown to us. Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your blessings. And we thank you for each and every godly mother. We give you praise and thanks for them. And I pray many blessings upon their lives. And I pray strength and peace upon them today. In your wonderful and glorious name, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. To each and every mom, I want to say happy Mother's Day to you. We love you and we appreciate you so very much here at CT. And I hope that this word has encouraged you and strengthened you in your faith to keep going and to keep living this word of God and this sincere faith and this example of service before your children each and every day. Let it be renewed in you today. I love you so very much, and I pray that you have a great rest of your day today. We've got a little something special that we want to show you as we conclude our service today. God bless you.
She cleans.
She babysits, and she does schooling on her computer to kind of be like a doctor.
She makes bills, then she puts them in the bank.
To clean the house.
She's a pediatric nurse practitioner. She helps us with schoolwork.
Take care of us.
To got to my bed.
Clean my room.
Did you wash your hands?
Look.
Clean your room.
I love you.
Go to your bed.
You aggravate the living daylights out of me.
I'm being silly.
And talented.
That we give a mommy cuddles at night.
When I clear the table.
I think she's in her 20s.
10.
35. And I can't believe I'm saying that on camera.
Me not listening to her?
From not being good.
When people talk, like me and Daddy will talk at the same times, and it gets on our last nerves.
Not cleaning up my room.
She goes grocery shopping.
Play Legend of Zelda?
Yeah, the gym. My mama is the best cooking lady.
Cooking.
Decorating and reading at church.
Exercising.
Tennis.
Spinking.
Riding my hoverboard.
Driving the car.
Board games.
Squats. Exercises.
Taking care of us by herself.
Baking.
She's not good at singing.
Taking care of the cats.
Lego building.
Singing.
She can't sing.
When he makes grilled cheese,
he's special to her.
Since you're crazy.
My dad makes really good cakes. He's handsome. And he's tall.
that he's always there for her.
Everything? Except for, like, the bikes.
That you go to work and make our money.
Happy Mother's Day!
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 Happy Mom, Happy Mother's Day!
Happy Mother's Day!
Happy Mother's Day!
Happy Mother's Day!
And Happy Mother's Day!
Happy Mother's Day!
Happy Mother's Day!
Happy Mother's Day!
Happy Mother's Day! Mwah, mwah, mwah!